बिस्मिल्लाह रहमान रहीम, अस्सलाम वालेकुम, दिस इज रुस्तम एंड आई वेलकम यू टू दिस फर्स्ट जूम मीटिंग। होप आई एम ऑडिबल टू यू। इफ आई एम ऑडिबल टू यू, यू आर रिक्वेस्टेड टू गो टू चैट बॉक्स एंड जस्ट टाइप यस। देयर इज अ बटन, मोर बटन, एंड क्लिक ऑन चैट एंड देन क्लिक ऑन यस और नो। Am I audible to you? Okay. So you are requested to join with your own name. Okay. Some of you are joining without any name, like only your mobile phone is just visible. So please join with your own name. You can rename yourself. Okay. Just go and click on participant, and then you can click on you can rename yourself, please. Okay, now get back to the main screen. So right now we have 12 participants in the Zoom meeting. We are waiting for few more to join us, and then inshallah we'll move ahead. So first of all, I'm just waiting for few more students so that they can join us. Zoom meeting, the purpose of Zoom meeting is that if students have got any problem, so this should be tackled in a face-to-face or synchronous mode. Okay, so let me check your chat for a while. Okay, so right now the participants are with me. Okay, Aiman, Alishpa, Aisha Khurshid, Isha, Afsa Gul, Muhammad Ali, Kaif, and Muqaddas Savera. And then we have Nurul Ain, Saba, Usama, then we have Sadullah. Okay, let me check all. So, okay. So it means a good number of students are present in the class. So let's move on. So let's move on. Okay, so first of all, these are the names of prominent Victorian novelists. So these are novelists. We have Charles Dickens, Thackeray, Charlotte Bronte, Emily Bronte, George Eliot, and Thomas Hardy. They all are very important novelists of Victorian age. Actually, Victorian age was particularly very famous for novel writing. And in this age, there was no drama, only poetry, prose, and fiction, that is novel. They were very important genres. And particularly today's meeting is being arranged to discuss some of the features of novels of Charles Dickens. Charles Dickens wrote about 15 novels, okay? And some of the novels I have mentioned here, as you can see, Great Expectations. Already, I shared a translation which I did for my second year students when I was teaching at UB College. And that, this chapter, this novel, it has got 59 chapters. And I tried to translate it and now share the translation with you. Hope you must have got through the translation. Now, a very important novel is David Copperfield, Oliver Twist, Bleak House, Hard Times. A long list is given here. You can peruse yourself. So we won't study all these novels because we are studying history of English literature. But whenever we study some age, let's say we are studying Victorian age, Queen Victoria, literature created in Britain in the reign of Queen Victoria. So we should at least be able to know about important works of that time. So now I have taken up Charles Dickens today. Otherwise, we will also be talking about these novelists like Charlotte Bronte and Emily Bronte, then George Eliot and Thomas Hardy. But mainly we'll focus on Charles Dickens and Thomas Hardy. And just to give you a taste about novels. And I will also share with you certain portions of these novels so that you may have a feel of it. Now let's move on to Charles Dickens. What type of artist was he? Before we talk about Charles Dickens, on the whole, let me talk about Victorian age. Here I'm gonna pause and I will request you to go to the chat box and just type, are you listening to me? Is it okay with voice clarity? Everybody is listening to me. Is it okay? Just type in the chat box. Do you get me? Okay, Usama Abdullah says it's okay. Okay, anybody else? Okay, Mohammed Kaif Ali, okay. So my voice is clear to you? Okay, can you see the screen? Okay, I have shared the screen, slides. Can you see the slides as well? Okay. Okay, thank you very much. Now come back to the presentation. Okay, it's okay, thank you. Now, in my previous lectures, I talked about generally about Victorian age. So literature created in every age is usually, you know, what should I say? There is a color, you know, the author lives in a particular age, okay? So author is usually, it's a theory. We have a literary theory that author sometime, some people believe that mostly authors, they are influenced by the age in which they live. Like people who lived in the age of Victoria and, you know, they were writing, they were creating literature. They were definitely under the influence of certain events like political events, social events. Like in Victorian age, this age was known as the age of industry. That is, industrial revolution was there. Industries were coming on the scene and agrarian economy like you know, fields and you know, agriculture, they that was being replaced with industrial you know, things like materialism and commercialism. It was coming up. So it was also age of doubt and belief because science was also there. Science was coming up, like Darwin wrote his book, important book, The Origin of Species, in which he propounded his own thought about you know, existence, life, etc. So people were very critical and skeptical about religion because whatever religion was preaching, people was just taking it with a grain of salt. Now people didn't believe whatever religion you know, offered to them. Now everybody had a inquisitive mind and they had some rational minds and they always tried to judge everything against the canons of science. So people were divided into two groups. One were Gnostics and another group was agnostics. People who, you know, they were skeptical, doubtful about religion. So really it was a mixed age of doubt and belief. And as far as materialism and commercialism are concerned, yes, then, you know, there are factories, mills, etc. There's a lot of money, capitalism, and definitely material prosperity is there. But as far as material prosperity is there, as you can see here at the bottom of the slide, prosperity, people are affluent, people have a lot of money and, you know, capital. But there is other picture as well, that there are sections of society who are living in total squalor, okay? Financially impoverished section of the society. So sufferings of factory workers and sufferings of children. Children were being made to work in factories. So on the one hand, we have capitalist economy, people who were minting money, people who were holding money, people who were just amassing a lot of wealth. And on the other side, we have people who, you know, who were ill-clothed and ill-fed. So, and the money gave the some of the people of this age snobbery and affectation. Like they were mostly snobs. They hated the downtrodden. They hated, you know, the poor people, and they lived lavishly and affected, you know, like aristocrats, etc. So these are some of the features or characteristics of Victorian age. So as Charles Dickens were writing under, you know, these very much very influences, So definitely all this would have found way into his novels. Okay, let's discuss his novels one by one, and then I'll show you some, you know, videos from some of the novels. If I had time, then I would show clips from all the videos. Otherwise, I would just pick one novel, like let's say Great Expectations, and then I'll show you certain, you know, scenes from Great Expectations. So now, Charles Dickens. First of all, we'll talk about Charles Dickens as a social reformer. Okay, social reform means that the writer wants to bring some change in society through his work. So his art was art had a purpose. Like usually we have art for the sake of art or art for the sake of life. There are two trends in creativity. So artists like poets, painters, you know, even the novelist, dramatist, they have two views about you know, their art. One is the pure artist, people who have the art for the sake of art, those who write art for aestheticism. The main purpose is to provide pleasure to the senses, to provide pleasure to the people. And the second purpose of the creating or literature or art is to, you know, introduce reforms into life. Like Lama Iqbal was a reformist. People who want to bring change in life through their literary creations, they are known as people with purpose. So Dickens was such a person. Although he was an artist, a very good artist, but he wanted to bring reform. Like there we can find a note of humanitarianism in his novels, okay? Here is an example of Bleak House, a novel. I won't go into detail because I have got only 40 minutes with me. So here, you know, large delays have been discussed. We know in Pakistan, people go to courts, they have their, you know, petty issues, but they don't get justice. And when the justice is dispensed to them, they are already in their grave. So the delay of the courts has been, you know, displayed through Bleak House. Hard Times is another important novel by Charles Dickens, in which he depicts plight of factory workers. Okay. Now, just a minute. Now, Little Dorrit. Here, you know, people who borrow money, and what happens when they are unable to pay back their debt. So, in humanities meted to debtors, they have been, you know, discussed and presented. Not only in humanities, you know, which were to which the debtors were being subjected, they were the main topic. There were other issues. There are other issues in this novel discussed, but we also have a glimpse of people who are unable to pay their debt back to their creditors. Then can we say that Charles Dickens was, you know, optimist or pessimist? You know, neither he says that all is right with the world, or nor he says that all is wrong with the world. So he is a realist. So he depicts both the sides of life, like Shakespeare, as Shakespeare knew that life was made from tragedy and comedy. So same is with Dickens. Dickens says that, yes, our world is, you know, littered, are soiled with so many, you know, injustices, so many bad aspects, but we won't say that we should be pessimist. We should say that no, there's no, you know, ray of hope in the world. So he says that yes, there is a ray of hope. So Dickens is both an optimist and a pessimist. So let's move to the next slide, and we will talk about Dickens' other like characterizations. So what type of characters did he present? Now, Dickens, you know, he had fertility of creative imagination. It means that he was able to create beauteous characters, okay? A variety of characters he introduced. So if we, you know, if we talk about him as a painter, okay? If he is a painter, so as a painter of life of his day, that is Victorian age, he works on a very big canvas. It means that he has got a very, you know, a variety of characters at his disposal. He presents in his novels, because he wrote more than 15 novels, both abnormal characters and abnormal characters. Abnormal characters are some, you know, they are satirical. Sometimes they are grotesque. Like when you just have a look at them, you just go into laughter. And sometimes you hate such characters. And then there are villains. So he also has presented beauteous characters, okay? But usually he is quite comfortable with depicting middle class life, okay? Because he himself has been witness to this life. Usually he don't bring in characters which belong to, you know, upper classes, particularly aristocrats, because he, although he, after being popular, because he was much popular writer of his time, so he was quite popular, not only in his country, that is England, rather he was a much acclaimed personality in Europe and even across Atlantic, in America as well, even in Russia, in Italy. He was a very popular novelist. People respected him very much. So in his later life, he had a chance to move into high circles. But when he was growing up, he saw the life of the people living around him. So he was a master, you know, painter of middle class life. So mostly his characters are from middle class life. And his characters are mostly flat. What are flat characters? There are two types of characters, like E.M. Forster has given this category to us. He is a novelist. Flat characters and round characters. And round characters are those characters, you know, which change. Like if at the start of the novel or the story, if they are bad, they may change into a good character later on. And if they are bad character, if they are good character at the start of a story, they may become, you know, what should I say? If they are good at the start of the story, they may become bad characters at the end. So they keep changing, round characters. But as far as flat characters are concerned, they usually are types. Okay, if they are good at the start of the novel, they will end up in goodness. So they will be good characters. So Dickens mostly presents flat characters, okay, types. So he presents types. Now I won't go into his characters one by one, because already we have consumed 17 minutes, because I will ask questions from you and I will give you platform to talk to me, to put up question. So I'm just rushing through this. It's our first meeting and I just want you to be present, you know, synchronically, so that we may have discussion on different topics. Now plot construction. Now, if you, as a student, you will not read all the novels, but if you happen to have a chance to go through all his novels, you will find that he is not very good at plot constructions. Why? Why he has, you know, neglected architectonic principles, that is plot constructions principles. Actually, his novels were published serially. So every month, a portion of his novel was published. In my own life, I used to, you know, read novels in serial publications. So usually a novel ends at a climax. You end a novel and we wait for the next issue or for the next installment after a month. And after a month, novel again comes into our hand. So these novels were not, you know, published in a book form in his, you know, initially. Initially, they were published in different newspapers are digest as a serial publications. So this mode of publication, you know, demands different things. Like their fans, readers, they used to suggest certain changes, like Great Expectations ending was changed. When initially Stella and, you know, Pip, they are shown as, you know, like they never meet the novel, and Pip does not get his love. So fans wrote letters to Dickens that this was not a very good ending. Pip should not be made such a tragic, you know, character. So he, at the end, at least he should be rewarded. So Charles Dickens changes last scene of Great Expectation, and the novel we study these days, in it, we see that Pip and Estella, two main characters, meet in Satis House, and they, and it is written that now they hold hand and Pip finds his love. So Charles Dickens used to, you know, mend his characters. That's why the plots are not very good. And so we should not say that this was a fault. Actually, it was because of the mode of publication, because of which he was unable to produce very good plots. Okay, now here I'm going to show you another important thing about Charles Dickens is that humor. Humor was, let me okay, let me bring it down. Okay, so regarding humor and pathos, they we can find these important elements in his novels. If you read original novel, because you are reading just summaries on the Google, or you are watching YouTube videos, which have been made on the novels. Actually, when you find time and you go through the novel itself, okay, then you come to know that Charles Dickens was a master humorist, like the way we have Chaucer and Shakespeare, and even Fielding. Fielding was a great novelist, Henry Fielding. We can find a lot of humor in the novels of Henry Fielding and in the works of Chaucer and Shakespeare. The same way, we find a lot of humor at every page of Charles Dickens' novel. Like when you watch the movie of Great Expectations, a novel by Charles Dickens, you can't help laughing. When Joe Gargery meets Miss Havisham, when Pip is made to have a bath, when he is sent to Santa's house, and there are so many scenes in every novel where you find laughter. Now, pathos. Yes, there are occasions in the novels when you find tears welling up in your eyes, okay? Like when Pip meets Miss Havisham and he says, "Miss Havisham, you have not been very good to me. You have done injustice to me. You have been very cruel to me." And we find Miss Havisham, being remorseful. And he says, "Okay, Pip, I have been very unkind to you. Now please forgive me." So there are scenes in novels where you find pathos in, and you feel pity with characters, and your tears well up in your eyes, and all this happens in the novels of Charles Dickens. Another important fact which I would like to mention is autobiographical touches. As I mentioned at the start of this lecture presentation, that a writer lives in a certain age. So he or she can never be free from the influences, political, social, religious influences of the age. So all this is depicted in the work. So if someone belongs to poor area, section of the society, and he or she becomes an artist, a writer, so his poverty will definitely find way into his or her works. So we can find some autobiographical touches in David Copperfield, Oliver Twist, Bleak House, and there are so many other works where you. But these are the representative works in which we whenever we meet Oliver, let's say. So we can see that the life of Oliver Twist is as if we were reading the life of Charles Dickens in his infancy and childhood. Even Charles Dickens met with certain accidents or incidents which we find happening to Oliver Twist. Now, I think it is suffice. Before I move to towards a new share, that is, I would like to show you certain portions from Great Expectations. So I would like you to come to chat box, okay, and just type your comments about whatever I have discussed just now. So any question up till now before we move to certain scenes from different novels, okay? Because many movies have been created on every novel, and these are very important movies, so I'm going to show you glimpses. So please just ask any question about Charles Dickens. If you don't have a question, just send a comment in chat box. I'm waiting. I'm reading your comments, please. Go ahead. So if you don't have a question, then I'm going to ask questions from you, okay? Okay, I'm going to request you to unmute one by one, and let's see what do you say about few things. Okay, okay, be ready. And if you have a question, you can raise hand. If you don't have a question, then I'm going to point you one by one. Okay, so first of all, any person who is volunteer to talk to me, okay, just raise your hand and I'm going to give you access and you can speak to me. Just you can comment, you don't need to ask a question, just make a comment. Okay, so who is raising hand? Hassan Ali. Hassan Ali, okay, please unmute yourself and say assalamu alaikum to the class and say few words to the class. Yes, please open unmute yourself. I have given you access, so click on unmute.
Assalamu alaikum.
Yes, please go ahead.
Sir, my question is, was it necessary to have a flat characters in Dickens characterization?
No, it was not necessary. Usually, when a writer writes, so characters automatically develop. Okay, let's say we have a character, Mrs. Joe Gargery, okay, in Great Expectation. So he is a flat character. Why? He is shown as a good person, okay, at the start of the novel, because he helps Pip on the dining table, okay? And whenever Mrs. Joe Gargery beats Pip terribly, and he is the person who saves Pip, and he is a gentle person, and he's a kind person. When Pip, falls ill in London, and he goes and, does the job of a nursing for a whole month, when Pip, has to pay money to people, Pip has lot of, loan to pay to debtors. So what happens? It is Joe Gargery who comes to his rescue and helps him, okay, pay his bills, etc. So he is a very good character. So sometime if the writer feels that character should be changed, so he changes the character. So you might have seen movies in which we see some person, very wicked person at the start, but at the end or during the progress of the play or the drama or the novel, he or she, becomes changed. So he becomes round characters. So it is the demand of the theme, etc. Okay?
Novel.
Okay?
Okay, sir.
Okay, you can lower your hand, mute yourself. Anybody else? Thank you. Okay, anybody else? Any brave person? Any question? Okay, let's who has raised hand? Hassan Ali, row number 3. Okay, please unmute yourself. Click on unmute. Yes.
So, why Homer and Pathos added in Dickens' novel?
What did you say?
Why Homer and Pathos added in Dickens' novel, or anyone else added this?
Actually, if humor and pathos are not added in the novels or stories or dramas, etc., who will read them? Let's say if I'm reading a novel, or if I'm watching a drama on TV, or if I'm watching a movie, let's say. So I would like to be entertained. If there is a tragedy, so three hearts tragedy, so I will become bored. So usually, in order to keep the readers, glued to the pages, or in order to keep the, TV watchers or people who are watching drama or films, etc., to keep intact their interest. So writers introduce variety of, strategies, like humor is added. So you just laugh over characters, over scenes. And after having a comic relief, okay, when you become entertained, then you are again pushed into the main action. So pathos, if you don't have feelings for some characters, so they are main ingredients of novels, plots, etc. So without humor and without pathos, no story will be complete. That's why they are introduced purposefully into novels. Because there are people who love laughter. There are people who love tragedy. There are people who love both laughter and tragedy. So all these elements are introduced. Okay, thank you. Hope your question is answered. Please mute yourself. Okay, anybody else? Now female students, hurry up please, time is, we have only 10 minutes left. So any question from a female student, Eamon? Okay, Aman, please go ahead. Yes, Aman, unmute yourself. Aman Javed, even if you have not raised your hand, just I'm requesting you to open your mic and say a few things to the class. What is your experience, today's experience? Aman, hurry up. Okay, Aman is not answering. So Aman does not want that he should be, he should know. Osama Abdullah, you want to ask, but wait a while. I want some female students to talk. So who is going to speak? So guys are not being courageous to talk. Okay, Khurshid, Aisha Khurshid, unmute yourself. Aisha Khurshid, unmute yourself and talk to the class. If those who are being pointed out and if they are not answering, they will be marked as absent today, mind it. Okay. Isha Tariq. It means you are not present in the class. You have just switched on your mic and it means you are not attending the class. Those who are being pointed out and they are not answering, it means they are not attending the class. Isha Tariq, if you are present, unmute yourself and talk. I have given you the access. Who is speaking right now?
Assalamu alaikum, everyone.
Okay, Vasna, who is it, please? Is it Isha Tariq?
Isha.
Okay, Isha, go ahead.
Isha. Yes, sir.
How was today's class? How
sir, can you explain?
No, I won't explain. Sir, because I've got only 6 minutes. Just make a comment quickly.
Okay, sir. Yes, sir, it was all good. I understood everything and everything is quite clear.
Okay, thank you. Now mute yourself. Manahil Wahid. Manahil Wahid, please open. Where are your name, Manahil? Raise your hand and just say a few words. Manahil, I think she is not present in the class. Okay, she is not present. Okay, then Anzala is present. Anzala Shahid. Okay, Anzala, unmute yourself and just make a comment. Anzala Shahid. Hurry up, please, Anzala. Okay, now raise your hand. If anyone wants to say a few words quickly, raise your hands. So Marail is present, but she is not talking. Marail is present here, Marail Wahid. Okay. Irsa Akram. Irsa Akram, are you present? Okay, who has raised his hand? Osama, quickly, please. Say a few words quickly. Hurry up.
Assalamu alaikum, sir.
Wa salam.
Assalamu alaikum. Sir, I was not clear about pathos, sir. Can you please explain, educate me on pathos?
Okay. Osama, we have got only 7 minutes. So I'll explain it in the WhatsApp group. So I'm just going to take you to the movie, okay? And you can ask this question for me in the WhatsApp group. So all are requested to come to the main screen. Okay. 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 Now I'm going to share, a video. Okay. And just watch. Here is a video. A pip is going to the churchyard. Okay. Okay, I'm going to pause it. Just come to the chat box and just tell me, can you see this movie? Come to the chat box and can you see the picture, please? Yes, Osama Abdullah. Okay, now I'm going to start the movie again. Okay, come to the main screen. This is the first scene, okay? Pip is just visiting graveyard. And he is visiting his grave of his mother, and he will meet Abel Magwitch.
Show us where you live. Sir Georgiana. That's my mother.
Ah, is that your father along with your mother?
Yes, sir, him too. Place of this parish.
Ah. And who do you live with? Supposing you're kindly let to live, which I ain't made up my mind about yet.
With my sister, sir. Mrs. Jo Gargery. Wife of Jo Gargery the blacksmith.
Blacksmith, eh? Now look at here. Do you know what a pile is?
Yes, sir.
Do you know what Whittles is?
Yes, sir.
And you get me a fire and you get me Whittles or I'll have your heart and liver out.
She'll try to let me keep that word, sir. Perhaps I shouldn't be sick and perhaps I can attend more.
You bring that fire and them Whittles to me in this churchyard tomorrow morning early.
Yes, sir.
And never dare to say a word if I've seen such a person as me.
No, sir.
If you do, your heart and liver will be tore out and roasted and ate. There's a young man hid with me, and in comparison with him, I'm an angel. That young man has a secret way of getting at a boy and at his liver. Boy may lock his door, may be warm in bed, but that young man will softly creep his way to him and tear him open. Say, heaven strike you dead if you don't.
Heaven strike me dead if I don't.
Now you know what you promised, young man. Get off home.
Good night, sir.
So you see, Pip met Abel Magwitch in the first chapter, and now he's running back to his house where he will meet with Jo Gargery. And let me, here is, this is Jo Gargery, okay? Now this is Mrs. Jo Gargery, and because Pip came back from the graveyard and she was searching for him, and she is now angry, she is beating, okay? Now see.
Now then, where have you been?
I've only been to the churchyard.
Churchyard, indeed. You would have been in a churchyard long ago if you hadn't been for me. And stayed there. Bad enough being a blacksmith, but I'm going to be a second mother to you. Churchyard, indeed. You'll be having me in the churchyard one of these days, keeping me on the rampage with my poor heart.
You can see this humorous character, Jo Gargery. He is quite terrified, and he can't speak, before his wife, and he is just keeping mum. So, okay. Now come back to the main screen. I'm again sharing the PowerPoint. So hope you have got few things about Charles Dickens. So the scene which I just presented, it was from Great Expectations, and hope you enjoyed today's online interaction. But be courageous and always participate in the class, and keep talking to each other. Keep asking questions, okay? Now come to the chat box and just say hello, and I'll say goodbye to each one of you. And let's finish today's class. I'm going to end the meeting. So you all are requested to come to chat box and comment and whatever you felt in the class today, okay? Okay, come to the class and give your comments. Was it okay? Did you enjoy the class? Okay, I'm reading your questions. Okay. Thank you very much. I'm going to end the meeting. Okay.